time's pride. This miracle was revealed over a long time span. Sent from Allah to an angel, then to a man. That man was Muhammad, the best of creation.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And welcome to a new episode of Correct Your Citation. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi wa kafa. Wasalamun ala ibadihi alladhina astafa. لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. All praise due to Allah alone, we praise him and we seek his help. Whomsoever Allah guides is the truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show him guidance. May the best peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Brothers and sisters everywhere, once again I greet you with the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Same as well to our beloved guests here in the studio, Sheikh Ismail. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa
rahmatullah. And our guest, Mir from Serbia, and Dino from Bosnia, Muhammad from Egypt. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaikum assalam wa
rahmatullah. As usual, we'll begin tonight's episode with a recitation of the chapter of the Quran, which will explain its meaning and practice the ahkam of tajweed on it. We'll listen to the beautiful recitation of Surah Al-Buruj by Sheikh Ismail. Please, tafaddal.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Was-samaa'i dhatil buruj. واليوم الموعود وشاهد ومشهود قتل أصحاب الأخدود النار ذات الوقود إذ هم عليها قعود وهم على ما يفعلون بالمؤمنين شهود وما نقموا منهم إلا العزيز الحميد الذي له ملك السماوات والأرض والله على كل شيء شهيد إن الذين فتنوا المؤمنين والمؤمنات ثم لم يتوبوا فلهم عذاب جهنم فلهم عذاب جهنم ولهم عذاب الحريق إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات لهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار ذلك الفوز الكبير إن بطش ربك لشديد إنه هو يبدئ ويعيد وهو الغفور الودود ذو العرش المجيد فعال لما يريد هل أتاك حديث الجنود فرعون وثمود بل الذين كفروا في تكذيب والله من ورائهم بل هو قرآن مجيد في لوح محفوظ.
ما شاء الله، جزاك الله خيرا. Thank you so much. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We stopped last time with the story of the boy and the king, and we learned from the explanation of verse number 10, which says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ فَتَنُوا الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَتُوبُوا فَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ جَهَنَّمَ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ الْحَرِيقِ. That Allah warns those who tried the believing men and women in order to hinder them from the path of Allah and convert them from the truth, that if they do not repent, Allah the Almighty warns them that they shall receive a severe torment in hell, the torment of the blazing fire. Then the following verse delivers a glad tidings and a good news to the believers, not any believers. Because the Quran also tells us that there are people who say, بأفواههم, by their mouths, we believe. يقولون بأفواههم ما ليس في قلوبهم, what they do not believe in. And in reality, do you not really mean it? Those are the hypocrites. So he says in verse number 11, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ ذَلِكَ الْفَوْزُ الْكَبِيرِ. Verily, those who believe and do good righteous deeds, for them Allah prepared gardens of heaven beneath which rivers are flowing, and that is indeed the great success, الفوز الكبير. Please examine again the beginning of this verse, verse number 11 of Surah Al-Buruj. إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات. You will never find in the entire Quran from cover to cover a mention of the believers without this condition. وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. They believed by their hearts, and they did the good righteous deeds by their limbs and body parts. So they verified their iman. الإيمان ما وقر في القلب وصدقه العمل. It is not sufficient to say we believe without really acting upon what we believe in. So every time there is a mention of belief or the believers, there is definitely a mention of their good righteous deeds in order to be eligible for the reward of Allah. جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي تَحْتَهَا مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. Rivers beneath those gardens would be flowing as a reward for the believers. The following verse is a serious threat and warning to those who persist and insist on disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and challenging Him. إِنَّ بَطْشَ رَبِّكَ لَشَدِيدٌ. Indeed, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the punishment of your Lord is very severe. Yeah. So warn the criminals, warn the non-believers and the sinners against His punishment. He is the one who يُبَدِئُ وَيُعِيدُ. إِنَّهُ هُوَ يُبَدِئُ وَيُعِيدُ. And no one else besides Him begins the creation and is able to recover the creation after their death. That is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Creator. He's the one who begins the creation, begins the punishment, and repeats the creation in the hereafter and repeats the punishment for the criminals and the disbelievers in the hereafter as well. So there is a punishment in this life and there is a punishment in the hereafter for those who disobey him. Sometimes Allah postpones the punishment in order to make it even severer than any punishment in this life. In the hadith, which is narrated by Ubad ibn Samit, may Allah be pleased with him, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took the Pledge of Allegiance from the believers several times. One of them was during the conquest of Mecca. And there is a particular bay'ah called bay'ah al-nisa, or the pledge of women, where women came in private and gave a pledge of allegiance to the Prophet ﷺ. Not to disbelieve in Allah nor sit partners to him in worship, not to commit adultery, not to lie, not to make any falsehood, not to steal, etc. There were six articles of this bay'ah. Then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and whosoever commits any of those sins in this life and receives the proper had or punishment for it, it will be a ransom or an expiation for the sin on the day of judgment. But if he was not punished for it, then his matter is up to Allah whether to punish him or to pardon him. We know that the companions, upon hearing that, those who are indulged into some of the major sins, such as ma'iz, al-mar'atu al-ghamidiyya, for instance, those who were involved in adultery, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, O Messenger of Allah, purify me. I would rather be punished in this life than having the punishment postponed for me in the hereafter. It is much easier and lighter, the punishment of this life. And that's why, for all the calamities, for all the sickness and the diseases that the Muslim will be afflicted with in this life, that these are all means of expiation for the sins of the believers in this life. وَهُوَ الْغَفُورُ الْوَدُودُ. Verse number 14. Al-Ghafoor is the of forgiven, the one who forgives all sins except for one sin, which is disbelief or sitting partners to Allah in worship. And the following trait or beautiful name of Allah is very interesting, which is Al-Wadud. Al-Wadud is the full of love. He is full of love towards the believers, and he is beloved to them. That is the meaning of Al-Wadud, that the believers are obsessed about the love of him, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is a very interesting catch in this verse. Because after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in verse number 12, إِنَّ بَطُشَ رَبِّكَ لَشَدِيدٌ, that indeed the punishment of your Lord is very severe. There he says in verse number 14, هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الْوَدُودُ, he is the all-forgiving and he is full of love. As an indication that if you repent unto Allah, and if you beg him for forgiveness before it's too late, then he shall grant you forgiveness. Not only that, he will forgive your sin, he will remit it, and he will exchange it for you with a good deed, and furthermore, he will love you. In the hadith that Allah the Almighty is more delighted and happy with the repentance of his servant more than the following case: than a servant or a person who's traveling, who's journeying, and he had his camel loaded with his provision, food and water, enough for the journey. He rested under a tree or the shade of a tree. Then he realized that when he got up, his camel ran away with all the provision. So he was certain that this is it for him. He's going to die. There is no way that he's going to make it. So while he was sitting, expecting his fate and death to come, there his ride, his camel, appeared before him once again. So he grabbed hold of it. And out of happiness, he wanted to thank Allah. So he said, O Allah, thank you so much. أنت عبدي وأنا ربك. You're my servant and I am your Lord. Out of happiness, he erred. He mistakenly said, O Allah, I thank you. You are my servant and I'm your Lord. Yeah. It was a slip of his tongue. This is an indication that he was extremely happy. He didn't know what he was saying. So Allah the Almighty is much more delighted with the tawbah of his servant than the case of this individual of having his camel coming back with his provision, which means that he will be saved and he will survive after he was certain that he was destroyed. Huwa al-ghafoor. So if you repent, he will grant you forgiveness. And furthermore, he will love you. Dhul arsh al-majid. He is the owner of the glorious throne. Well, he's the owner of everything. He is the owner of the heavens and the earth. He is the owner of us. He is the owner of everything he created. So why particularly in this ayah Allah specified Al-Arsh, the glorious throne? Because it is the nearest to Allah. It is above everything that he created, above the seven heavens. And it is the greatest creature ever. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the seven heavens and earth and Al-Kursi compared to Al-Arsh, the throne of Allah the Almighty, is like a ring thrown in desert, in an open desert. Al-Kursi itself, which is the footstool, is like a ring compared to the throne, like a ring thrown in desert. While the heavens and the earth and what they contain compared to the kursi is like a ring thrown in a desert. So basically, it is hard to imagine how great is the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَحْمِلُ عَرْشَ رَبِّكَ فَوْقَهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ ثَمَانِيَةٍ ذُو الْعَرْشِ الْمَجِيدِ المجيد.
Again, what is the difference between the kursi and the throne?
Al-kursi is much, much smaller than al-arsh. Al-arsh is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-arsh istawa.
Yeah.
While al-kursi is the place which we call it the footstool. So it is very small compared to al-arsh. As in the hadith as stated, كَحَلْقَةٍ مُلْقَاتٍ فِي فَلَا. Then, there is a very interesting thing here relating to the Arabic grammar. There is a recitation or a dialect which says Dhul Arsh al-Majidu, and there is another one which says Dhul Arsh al-Majidi. So if we say Dhul Arsh al-Majidu, then al-Majid, which is the glorious, is an attribute of Dhu, that's Allah the Almighty.
Yeah.
So Allah the glorious, the most high, he is the owner of the throne. But if it is with the kasra, then Dhul Arsh al-Majidi, the word al-Majid or the glorious, is an attribute of the throne itself, because al-Arsh is with kasr. Then another trait of Allah is fa'alun lima yurid. It's an intensive form. Not that he only does what he wants once or twice or occasionally, constantly. He is the doer of whatever he intends. Anytime that he intends or wills to do anything, he does it. So, well, humans sometimes argue with it and say, I do whatever I wish, I'm a free man. You know, if you go to Europe and the States, people think freedom, that I do whatever I want to do. They don't understand that that freedom is also restrained. Because every time a person, no matter how authoritative is this person, wants to do anything, there are helpers and there are obstacles, right? For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has neither one of them, neither helpers nor obstacles. Simply, إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا أَن يَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونْ. If he intends to do anything, he simply say to it, be, and it is. It is created. He doesn't need any helpers. هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ الْجُنُودِ. Then there is a shift. In verse number 17, Allah will take us to another story. Repeatedly in the Quran, Allah mentioned the stories of Ad with Thamud and the Pharaoh and his people. Ad are the people of Prophet Hud. Thamud are the people of Prophet Salih. And قوم فرعون are the people of the Pharaoh, Moses Pharaoh. هل أتاك حديث الجنود? Has the story reached you of the hosts? Because they had hosts, they have armies, they threatened the believers' party. What happened to them? They were all destroyed. The people of Ad with a violent wind over 7 nights and 8 days. And the people of Thamud with an out loud cry, they were all dead. And the Pharaoh and his hosts were drowned before Musa alayhi salam and before the eyes of the believers. بَلِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فِي تَكْذِيبِ I mean, there should be enough lessons and admonition for the disbelievers afterward, after what they have seen, what happened to the people of Ad and Thamud and the Pharaoh. Yet, they persist on belying and denying the prophets, particularly Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you continue to belie, you gotta understand, وَاللَّهُ مِنْ وَرَائِهِمْ مُحِيطٍ Allah encompasses them from behind. What does it mean that He encompasses them? He encompasses them with His infinite knowledge, so He knows exactly their actions, their deeds, and their intentions. And not only that, He encompasses them with His infinite power, that whenever He wants to see them, إِنَّ أَخْذَهُ أَلِيمٌ شَدِيدٌ Severe and powerful. So whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He may postpone and give respites, as He says in the following surah, Surah At-Tariq. فَمَهِّلِ الْكَافِرِينَ أَمْهِلْهُمْ رُوَيْدًا Give them a respite and deal with them gently. Because whenever it is time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would seize them with no mercy. وَاللَّهُ مِنْ وَرَائِهِمْ مُحِيطٌ For their evil doing, Allah encompasses them with His infinite knowledge and with His infinite and endless power. بَلْ هُوَ قُرْآنٌ مَجِيدٌ Nay, indeed, that is a glorious Qur'an. This is a glorious Qur'an. Qur'an full of knowledge, Qur'an full of wisdom, Qur'an full of vast ma'arif and acknowledgement, Qur'an full of what will benefit humanity at large, في لوح محفوظ. This Quran is preserved in the preserved tablet. So it is not a subject of change. No one can reach it. No one can alter it. No Satan can play in it. And this is one thing which the disbelievers cannot comprehend or understand. Even though they have been trying ever since the Quran was revealed, they have been trying to add to the Quran, or take out of it, or change it, but they failed. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Hijr, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ So it is Allah who preserved this Quran in the preserved tablet, and He preserved the Quran in the hearts of the Huffaz. We'll take a short break and we'll return back to practice the recitation of this great surah, Surah Al-Buruj. So please stay tuned.
Recite it every day and do read it loud.
Closing the gap.
Why closing the gap?
In this program, Sheikh Yusuf Estes and Omar Dunlap are going to discuss how to bridge the gap between peoples of different cultures and orientations. The gap between males and females, Muslims and non-Muslims, the East and the West.
Human beings feel like that they're being slighted one way or the other. The gap between the youth and the elders, the gap between various status in working, the work field and education, and then trying to provide solutions for these particular problems.
All of this and more in Closing the Gap, soon in Ramadan on Hoda TV. Amazing stories. In this program, we get to know about people of the past whose stories were mentioned in the Islamic tradition and related by the Prophet, peace be upon him.
that verily us, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we tell you about the best of the stories. We tell you about the best of the stories. When we narrate a story, when we read a story, when we try to benefit from a story, what we are trying to do in reality is to go back through the steps, through the different parts and sections of this story until the story is actually completed and that we can take the actual benefit directly from the story.
Sheikh Lutfi will narrate these stories in his program Amazing Stories.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered one of the lands to come closer, the destination. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered one whole city to come closer, to move closer to this dead person.
Amazing Stories, soon in Ramadan on Hoda TV.
Join me this Ramadan in our new program, One Step Closer. Each day, we'll take one step closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One step closer to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One step closer to the Quran. One step closer to our way of life. Each day we will explore the acts of worship that we do and we will find out how they relate to our hearts, how they impact our soul, how they help us understand the reality of existence, how they can lead us to success. All of this and much more in our show, One Step Closer. Join us from Sunday to Thursday, every day after Taraweeh in Mecca. You can share with us and you can always call in because the show will be live. You can send us your emails on our email address, onestepcloser@huda.tv. All of you are invited to join us. Share your stories, share your aspirations, share your love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll be happy to have you on board. Join us in One Step Closer.
Recite it every day and do read it loud.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh and welcome back. We'll be more than happy to take your phone calls. For those who would like to join us live, correcting the recitation. Today, inshallah, we'll begin reciting from Surah Al-Buruj. We'll begin with our guest from Serbia, Elmir, right? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Please, go ahead and recite Surah Al-Buruj from the beginning, please.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والسماء ذات البروج واليوم الموعود وشاهد ومشهود قتل أصحاب الأخدود النار ذات الوقود إذ هم عليها قعود وهم على ما يفعلون بالمؤمنين شهود وما نقموا منهم إلا أن يؤمنوا بالله العزيز الحميد الذي له ملك السماوات والأرض والله على كل شيء شهيد.
جزاك الله خيرا. We'll get back to verse number 9 with you. Amir, we'll take first brother Nabash from Cairo. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalam.
How are you?
Fine.
Okay, let's go ahead and recite from the beginning of Surah Al-Buruj again.
Okay, please, I have a question before I start reading.
Absolutely, go ahead.
Please, I promised that I was going to fast when I passed my exams, and I passed. Please, is it okay to fast tomorrow since Ramadan is approaching?
Hold on 1 second. You promised to fast?
Yeah.
To fast how many days?
Just for 1 day, if I pass my exam.
Okay. And now you want it to make it up during Ramadan?
No. Can I do it now before Ramadan?
Yes, you may. It is okay. You can do it. But guess what? This is the last time we answer a question on correct recitation. So we'll make an exception for you this time. And as we know that the Prophet ﷺ recommended for us to cease fasting, voluntary fasting, at the middle of Sha'ban in order to prepare ourselves for the big fasting during the month of Ramadan. Unless if a person had the habit of constantly fasting on Mondays and Thursdays, or for an excuse such as a person or a woman who has to make up the missed days of the previous Ramadan before the next Ramadan, or like in this case, our brother, young brother, who made a vow to fast for one day if he passed the exam and he wants to fulfill it before Ramadan. So it is perfectly okay to fulfill your vow before Ramadan, inshallah, even though it is a few days before the beginning of Ramadan. Now, are you ready to recite?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والسماء ذات البروج. واليوم الموعود. وشاهد ومشهود. قتل أصحاب الأخدود. النار ذات الوقود. إذ هم عليها قعود وهم على ما يفعلون بالمؤمنين شهود.
Can you clarify the hamza of بالمؤمنين؟
بالمؤمنين شهود. وما نقموا منهم إلا أن يؤمنوا بالله العزيز الحميد.
This verse again and make sure the hamza is clear.
وما نقموا منهم إلا أن يؤمنوا بالله العزيز الحميد الذي له ملك السماوات والأرض والله على كل شيء شهيد.
Okay, now it has become very clear that you need to work on the qalqala, on the dal, in verse number 8, العزيز الحميد. And in verse number 9, وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ. It will be sufficient if you can just repeat verse number 9 again.
الَّذِينَ هُمْ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْعَرْضِ وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ.
Beautiful, mashallah. I do not regret answering your question, but let me give you a simple advice. The nostrils, make sure they're open. Only in the case of the ghunna, we use them or utilize them. But sometimes, especially when we were very young and particularly kids, we wanted to copy and imitate big reciters. So we used to close the nostrils in order to produce ghunna in every letter. While this is an error, that's called lahn. So make sure that the air passage in the nostrils is open. So you say, الَّذِي لَهُ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. By the way, I still have the same problem with my kids. Whenever they wanted to copy or imitate me, so they would think by closing their nostrils and pronouncing the ghunna with every letter, that makes them a better sound. Jazakallahu khairan, and thank you so much. Okay, I would request you to recite verse number 9 again before I continue with Dino.
الَّذِي لَهُ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ.
جزاكَ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا. Continue, please.
إِنَّ الَّذِينَ فَتَنُوا الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَتُوبُوا فَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ جَهَنَّمَ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ الْحَرِيقَ. إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات لهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار ذلك الفوز الكبير.
Thank you. جزاك الله خيرا. Hussein from United Arab Emirates. السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله.
How are you?
الحمد لله وشكر الله.
Great. Would you please go ahead and recite from verse number 11? Of Surah Al-Buruj, obviously.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات لهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار ذلك الفوز الكبير إن بطش ربك لشديد إنه هو يبدع ويعيد.
حسين verse number 13, look at the word يبدع. I highlighted it in red. إنه هو يبدئ. That's a همزة not a عين. Okay. إنه هو يبدئ ويعيد.
إنه هو يبدئ ويعيد.
Wait.
وهو الغفور الودود ذو العرش المجيد فعال لما يريد. هل أتاك حديث الجنود فرعون وثمود.
Why is the rush? I prefer that you stop on top of each and every ayah. That was the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad's recitation. So it would sound much better if you stop by the end of each ayah.
Okay. هل أتاك حديث الجنود فرعون وثمود بل الذين كفروا في تكذيب والله من ورائهم محيط بل هو قرآن مجيد في لوح محفوظ.
جزاك الله خيرا حسين. Follow me please in verse number 18. There is a letter Ra. Normally the Ra, if it has fatha or dhamma, zabar or zair, then it is mufakhama, it is fat, such as ar-Rahman, ar-Rahim, Rabbi al-Samawati. But when it has a kasra, then it is very thin, right? And such as rizqam min ladunna. Or if it has sukun and preceded by kasra, such as in the word fir'aun, that is the most famous word. So it is an error to say fir'aun. No. Rather, you should say fir'aun. Fir'aun. The ra is very, very thin. Okay? Also in verse number 19, the word takzib. There is hams on the kaf. Not qalqala. You cannot shake the kaf. Every time you have a letter ba in the entire Quran, in every sentence, in every word, the ba is very thin. So you should say bal, not bal. Okay? Jazakallah khairan Hussein, and thank you so much. Ruqayya from Egypt. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
How are you?
I'm fine.
Good. Alhamdulillah shukla. What about if we recite from the beginning of Surah Al-Buruj again?
Okay.
Go ahead.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والسماء ذات البروج واليوم الموعود وشاهد ومشهود قتل أصحاب الأخدود النار ذات الوقود إذ هم عليها قعود وهم على ما يفعلون بالمؤمنين شهود وما نقموا منهم إلا أن يؤمنوا بالله العزيز الحميد.
Beautiful, but clarify the hamza of يؤمنوا.
وما نقموا منهم إلا أن يؤمنوا بالله العزيز الحميد الذي له ملك السماوات والأرض والله عز
على كل شيء شهيد. I could hear Sheikh Ismail keep saying ما شاء الله ما شاء الله ما شاء الله. Very impressive. Thank you Ruqayya. May Allah bless you and your family. This is a great approval sign from Sheikh Ismail. I'd like to hear you saying ما شاء الله when I recite too. Okay, Dino. Verse number 10.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الذين فتنوا المؤمنين والمؤمنات ثم لم يتوبوا فلهم عذاب جهنم ولهم عذاب الحريق. إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات لهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار ذلك الفوز الكبير. إن بطش ربك لشديد إنه هو يبدئ ويعيد وهو الغفور الودود ذو العرش المجيد فعال لما يريد. هل أتاك حديث الجنود فرعون وثمود بل الذين كفروا في تكذيب والله من ورائهم محيط بل هو قرآن مجيد في لوح محفوظ.
MashaAllah, very beautiful. JazakAllah khair. There is a very interesting thing I wanted to point out here in verse number 11. The verse says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. And we just learned the meaning that Allah promises the believers who do good righteous deeds that He will give them gardens beneath which rivers are flowing. Sometimes, and this verse is repeated in many, many places in the Quran, up to here. So some people when they recite and they run out of breath, they say, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي and they stop. In order to say تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ, this is a very awful stop because it changes the meaning. So because when you stop at جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي, that means that the gardens or heaven is running. While the meaning is not like that at all. It means جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. Rivers flown beneath those heavens. So for them there are heavens beneath them, rivers are flowing. So the word flowing or تَجْرِي or running, if you stop at it, then it will change the meaning. It will give you the impression that what's running is the gardens or al-jannat, while what's running is what? The rivers beneath al-jannat. Okay, thank you so much. Muhammad Chindi, now it's your chance to hear MashaAllah from Sheikh Ismail and from me. We'll go ahead and recite from the beginning of Surah Al-Buruj.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والسماء ذات البروج واليوم الموعود وشاهد ومشهود قتل أصحاب الأخدود النار ذات الوقود إذ هم عليها قعود وهم على ما يفعلون بالمؤمنين شهود وما نقموا منهم إلا أن يؤمنوا بالله وما نقموا منهم إلا أن يؤمنوا بالله العزيز الحميد الذي له ملك السماوات والأرض والله على كل شيء شهيد إن الذين فتنوا المؤمنين
The غنة, two counts. Sometimes we slip or we skip the غنة. Say إن. It's got to be two counts. إن الذين آمنوا
إن الذين فتنوا المؤمنين والمؤمنات ثم لم يتوبوا فلهم عذاب جهنم ولهم عذاب الحريق إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات لهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار ذلك الفوز الكبير إن بطش ربك لشديد إنه هو يبدئ ويعيد وهو الغفور الودود ذو العرش المجيد فعال لما يريد هل أتاك حديث الجنود فرعون وثمود بل الذين كفروا في تكذيب والله من ورائهم محيط بل هو قرآن مجيد في لوح محفوظ.
ما شاء الله. What do you think, Sheikh Ismail? MashaAllah. You got it. Thank you. Jazakallahu khairan. Brothers and sisters, before the end of today's program, I would like to remind myself and all of you that Ramadan is just around the corner. It's a matter of a few days. So we have to put our head together and plan better for the best Ramadan in our life. Ramadan this year, inshallah, has to be different than any other Ramadan before. It could be our last Ramadan. You never know. And Ramadan is a wonderful divine opportunity in order to wipe out our previous sins and earn magnitude of reward. Ramadan is the month of the Quran. So we have to pay a lot of attention to the Quran in Ramadan in many different ways. Recitation, studying its meaning, listening to the recitation of the Quran, attending the halqa in the masjid if you live in a community where you have an access to attend the halqa, particularly after Fajr. I can just give you a very little hint. For everybody that you can finish the Quran at least once in Ramadan, easy. If you pray Fajr in jama'ah in the masjid, then you stay there in order to recite your morning adhkar and one juz. One juz with a steady reading, an average rhythm, will take about 40 minutes. Then after you finish, it will be already past sunrise, you pray two rak'ahs. Now let's discuss the magnificent reward of that. For each letter you recite, you receive as minimum 10 good deeds. Yeah. So imagine hundreds of thousands of good deeds for reciting this one para or juz every day. Two, the Prophet ﷺ said that one who prays Fajr in Jama'ah, then sits to remember Allah and it is sunrise, then prays two rak'ahs, those two rak'ahs which we owe Allah as means of gratitude for the blessings of the joints, the 360 joints, yeah, or small bones in our bodies, that Allah will give him the reward of performing complete Hajj and Umrah. Not every Muslim can afford to perform Hajj or Umrah. There is 1.4 or 5 billion Muslims. And the maximum number Mecca can encompass at a time is 2.73 million pilgrims. So even the poor have a chance, and every person have a chance to perform Hajj and Umrah in a sense of earning the reward of performing Hajj and Umrah. Because some people might think, well, I can do that and I don't have to go. No, if you have the means and you're physically fit, then you must perform the Hajj and Umrah at least once per lifetime. But imagine every single day, you can perform perfect, complete Hajj and Umrah, as the Prophet ﷺ said, tammatayni, tammatayni. And this whole thing would not take more than an hour and 20 minutes, an hour and a half at maximum. And this is an experience which if you observe it on a regular basis during Ramadan, I promise that you will sense a great change in your life, in your manners, in your relationship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is guaranteed that you're going to finish the Quran once during Ramadan for every average person. Then if you get to pray Taraweeh with the Imam in a masjid, and please make sure that you choose a masjid or an Imam who recites slowly, not an express Imam, because the purpose is to understand what's been recited upon you in the prayer, to enjoy it. So you get to recite, you attend behind an Imam who recites one para every night in Taraweeh. So by the end of the month, you will get to finish the Quran twice. This is at least as we say. So let me remind you with the great virtues of this month. This is a month during which once the month of Ramadan begins, the gates of heaven will be open wide and the gates of fire will be closed and Satan's will be chained. So Allah is opening for us the gates of heaven and He's calling unto us to enter it. So let's compete, since a caller from heaven will call, Ya baghi al khayr aqbil, Ya baghi al sharr aqsar. O caller of goodness, come forward. And O callers, or a person who intends to do evil, aqsar, stay back or sit back. So we would like to be among us, baghi al khayr. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a long life to live to witness this beautiful Ramadan and make it the best Ramadan at all. Wa sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Until next time, I leave you in the care of Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Brothers and sisters, to increase your iman, read the miracle, recite the Quran. Recite it every day and do read it loud. The verses of Quran are all Muslims' pride. This miracle was revealed over a long time span, sent from Allah to an angel then to a man. That man was Muhammad, the best of creatures.